Calling meeting to order. We'll start with a prayer from Chaplain Zach Sutton, Panama City Chaplain, Pastor of Catalyst Church.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I was reminded this morning of your sovereignty. Your sovereignty of all things, and that includes the leaders and the authorities that you put in power. And so, Father, this morning, I pray that the leaders you have put in place approach the decisions and the things of matter with humility, integrity, grace, and a reverence of you. Father, just lead this room, lead the discussions, and Father, lead the decisions. We want to give over all sovereignty in our lives to you, Lord, including this place. We thank you. We praise you. We want to give all glory and honor to you because you're the only one that deserves it. We pray that in your holy Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our pledge.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Darlene, would you call the roll?
Commissioner Brown.
Here.
Commissioner Rader.
Here.
Commissioner Nichols.
Here.
Commissioner Halagus is out today. Mayor Brudnicki.
Here. We have the minutes from the July 10th meeting. I've had a chance to read those. Everyone's okay with the minutes as presented. So say with a motion to accept.
Yes, Mayor, if it's okay, I'd like to make a motion to move approval of the City Commission minutes from the July 10th meeting.
Second the motion, Mayor.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown.
Yes.
Commissioner Rader.
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols.
Yes.
Mayor Brudnicki.
Yes. We have this morning, we're going to appoint another person to the Supplemental Retirement Board. We have one applicant that wants to stay on there, Henry Hooks. And our other Carter Minimalist does not want to. We have had no one else to apply for that position. So do I hear a motion to confirm Henry Hooks to remain on the Supplemental Pension Retirement
Board? Yes, I'd like to move approval to, I spoke with Mr. Hooks, yeah, is that what, excuse me, the other day, and he said he's very humble to be able to serve on that, and he's very knowledgeable, and so I make that motion.
Second the motion, Mayor.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown.
Yes.
Commissioner Rader.
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols.
Yes.
Mayor Brudnicki.
Yes. We have a list. Now, we need people to apply for the Board of Adjustment, Downtown Improvement Board, Employee Pension Fund Board, and the Supplemental Retirement Board, which I just mentioned. So those four different boards are needing people. If you would like to apply for those, please get with our CFO. Darlene at the City Hall, temporary City Hall, and get an application. Devin?
I'd like to announce at the end of this meeting, the meeting will not conclude, but it will happen at the end of the meeting. There'll be an executive session that has been duly noticed and advertised, and it's to consider the case of Jack Stewart versus City of Panama City acting by and through its Board of Adjustment, case number 18-300CA. It'll be announced at that time also, but those in attendance will be the city manager, the city commissioners, and the city attorney's office.
Thank you. Go on, final reading of ordinance 2649.1, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect the land use designation of general commercial for property at 807 to 823 East 15th Street. Hear a motion?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make the motion that we accept. Approve.
Hear a second?
Second.
This is a public hearing. Anyone would like to address us? Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown.
Yes.
Commissioner Rader.
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Commission has adopted ordinance number 2649.1, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of general commercial for a parcel of property located at 807, 821, and 823 East 15th Street, Panama City, Florida, providing for a repealer, providing for severability, and providing for an effective date.
Item reading of ordinance 2649.2, amending the zoning map of the city reflect a zoning designation of general commercial to property located 807 to 823 East 15th Street. Do I hear a motion?
Mayor, I'd like to make that motion that we approve.
Second the motion.
Discussion. Call roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Ryder?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes.
Commission adopted ordinance number 2649.2, an ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at 807, 821, 823 East 15th Street, Panama City, Florida, having approximately 2.38 acres, general commercial two, providing for severability and providing for an effective date.
Final reading of 2655.1, voluntary annexation of 0.6 acres of property located at 3046 West 30th Court. This is a public hearing. Hear a motion?
I'd like to move approval. Item 6C.
Or second?
Second the motion, Mayor.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Ryder?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Commission has approved ordinance 2655.1, an ordinance of the city approving the voluntary annexation of 0.6 acres of unincorporated property located at 3046 West 30th Court, Bay County, Florida, into the city as further defined hereinafter, amending the wards and boundaries of the city to include said land and providing for an effective date.
Continuing the public hearing. Final reading of ordinance 2655.2, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of residential for property located at 3046 West 30th Court. Do I hear a motion?
Move approval.
Second the motion, Mayor.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Ryder?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Commission has approved ordinance 2655.2, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of residential for a parcel of property located at 3046 West 30th Court, Panama City, Florida, providing for repealer, severability, and providing for an effective date.
Okay. Final reading of ordinance 2655.3, amending the zoning map of the city reflect a zoning designation of R1 for property located at 3046 West 30th Court. Do I hear a motion?
Approval of ordinance number 2655.3.
Second the motion, Mayor.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Ryder?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Commission has adopted ordinance 2655.3, an ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at 3046 West 30th Court, Panama City, Florida, having 0.6 acres, residential one, providing for severability, providing for an effective date.
Okay, we have final reading of ordinance 2656.1, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use for property located at 1135 Magnolia Avenue. This is a public hearing.
I'd like to move approval of ordinance 2656.1.
The mayor, I'd like to second the motion on that, even though we had a couple of questions on it. But I did talk to Mr. Jarrett, and he explained it and got it clear to me, and I thank him for that.
Okay. Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Ryder?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes.
Commission has approved ordinance 2656.1, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of residential for a parcel of property located at 1135 Magnolia Avenue, Panama City, Florida, providing for repealer, severability, and an effective date.
Final reading of ordinance 2656.2, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of mixed use 2 for property located at 1135 Magnolia Avenue.
I'd like to make approval for that, Mayor.
Second the motion.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Commission has adopted ordinance number 2656.2, an ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at 1135 Magnolia Avenue, Panama City, Florida, having approximately .44 acres mixed use 2, providing for severability and providing for an effective date.
Okay, we have one item on the consent agenda. Your motion to approve?
Yes, Mayor, I'd like to move approval of item 7A for the block party for city employees and thank Houston's First Baptist Church for doing that for us.
Second the motion, Mayor.
Houston, Texas, I guess.
Okay, any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am. Jared?
First item today, consideration of acceptance of the Edward Byrne Memorial Justice Assistance Grant in the amount of $26,662.42, and for a budget amendment in the same amount with the accompanying resolution. This grant was approved for application at the September 26, 2017 commission meeting. This grant is 100% reimbursable, therefore no matching funds are required.
Your motion?
You want to make the motion?
I'd like to make a motion that we approve.
I'll second that, that's a great thing.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
I approve with the resolution attached as well.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
And that resolution is number 2018-0724.2, a resolution providing for the amendment of the approved fiscal year 1718 budget for the acceptance of the Edward Byrne Memorial JAG grant to purchase a vehicle and equipment for the crime scene unit.
Consideration of $33,960 fee for Volker, Inc. to prepare maintenance dredging plans and permit documents for Massalina Bayou and Lake Van Vack Watson Bayou. Volker was selected as one of the engineering firms with the general engineering consultant RFQ process and approved by the commission at the May 23, 2017 meeting. Subconsultant services are included and will be provided through Volker for surveying geotech and environmental mapping as provided for the attached proposal. With approval, a task order under the GEC contract will be issued. Staff recommends approval.
Your motion on 8B?
I'd like to motion for approval.
Second?
I'll second. I have a question. At what point do they get the final permitting for a project like that? I know that they're going to be the engineering.
Is this just the first
step of this? Have the permits already been approved, or?
Neil, would you like to address that?
No, part of their task will be to get the permits. They'll do the surveying, the design, and then apply for the permits, and once that's done, then we'll go out for bid.
And so, is that included in their bid?
Yes, sir, it is.
Okay, good, that's what I wanted to know. Thank you, Neil. Thank you.
Okay, we have motion and second. Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Award of task order to Mott McDonald in the amount of $171,000 for the 11th Street Water Main Improvements Phase 1. This existing cast iron water main on 11th Street is heavily tuberculated and needs to be upgraded to a more modern PVC pipe. This project has been divided into three phases, with Phase 1 being from Frankfurt Avenue to Balboa Avenue. This project will coincide with the Baker Court utility improvements and improve water quality in the area. Staff recommends approval.
Motion on 8C?
Approval of 8C.
Second the motion.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Ryder?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brodnicki?
Yes, ma'am.
Consideration of award of lift station 92 improvements to Royal American Construction in the amount of $266,144. Bids were received on June 26, 2018 for the lift station 92 improvements. Project work consists of a new wet wall, electrical panel pumps, and all apparatuses. Bids were as follows: American Construction, $266,144. LNR Contracting, $269,403. North Florida Construction, $284,873. And Marshall Brothers Construction at $398,600. Bids have been reviewed by staff, and Dewberry and Royal American Construction has been determined to be the low bidder. Staff recommends approval.
Motion on 8D.
Approval of 8D.
Second the motion, Mayor.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Ryder?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brodnicki?
Yes, ma'am.
Consideration of additive change order and budget amendment resolution number 201807.24.1 in the amount of $240,546.31 for the Jinx Avenue widening project. This change order is for additional costs associated with AT&amp;T delays covering March to June of 2018. The contract price will be increased from $6.218326,068 to $6,458,872.99. Recommend approval for change order and the budget amendment resolution.
Ask a question. When's this project going to be done on Jinx Avenue?
Last schedule that GAC gave us, their completion date is already passed. It was about the middle of this month. They have come in recently and asked us for additional days because of weather. Went back to them and asked for some additional information and have not received that yet. So I would anticipate, though, that they're going to finish it before the end of August.
Maybe for Jared, somebody? And this may not be a fair question because I know you can't.
None of us could predict.
Other change order in this coming our way?
I don't know for sure, but I anticipate that this is the last one.
This is giving me major heartburn.
Since we're almost to the end of their performance period, and even the request for additional weather days, there should be no cost associated with that.
I hope so. Thank you.
Your motion on 8D?
Move approval of 8D.
Second the motion.
Discussion.
If you would like, I know that the commissioners had authorized litigation.
I was going to ask him to come up before we, after we voted.
Okay.
Yep. Good, we're thinking same. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Ryder?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brodnicki?
Yes. Cliff?
Yes, I'd like to read the resolution. And the resolution is 2018-07-24.1, a resolution providing for the amendment of the approved fiscal year 17-18 budget for the Jinx Avenue widening project.
Yes, Cliff Higbee, Bryant Higbee. Just to update you all, we have a four-count complaint that we have finalized and are ready to file against AT&amp;T regarding the change order that you approved. And just for the benefit of the commission, the change orders to date directly attributable to delay caused by AT&amp;T amount to $983,924. So we believe this is a matter of significant import to the city, and we plan on pursuing litigation, as you all have authorized. Expert witness who was in town recently, he's participated in a case exactly like this against AT&amp;T. Book, but they have not been responsive. and I think the city's last option is about to be employed. If any of you have questions during the course of this, let me know, but we feel good about the complaint. We feel good about the lawsuit. We, of course, have an agreement with GAC that if they get brought into this, or if finds that they are in some way responsible, then they will be reimbursing the city
for those. Yeah, Mr. Higby, so on a suit like this, do we go for attorney's fees as well in a suit like this?
The statute 337.403 does not provide a statutory right to attorney's fees, and of course we don't have a contract with AT&T. Typically you have to have either a contract or a statute authorizing attorney's fees. What I will most likely do is very early in the litigation request from the city authorization to make what's called a proposal for settlement, and if we go to court and beat the proposal for settlement, then we would have a right to recover fees. But we certainly keep that on the radar, and we'll do our best to handle it economically and expeditiously and move along.
Any other questions? Very good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Appreciate you.
Thank you.
Hey, Jerry. Already voted.
So I'm going to turn this over to Brandy.
Just give a brief overview of the fiscal year 2019 proposed budget.
Set the dates and times first.
We can.
First on the.
There's two considerations for today, which one is to set the date and time and meeting place of the tentative budget hearing. So if we'd like to do that. Staff is recommending that we do that on Thursday, September the 13th, and last slide on here. We have to work around the school board and the county.
Right.
So we are recommending Thursday, September 13th at 5:01 p.m. Right here at the Bay County Chambers.
Your motion?
Yes, I'd like to make a motion that we meet on Thursday, September 13th for the suggested first hearing for the millage rate and the budget.
Your second?
Second the motion.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
I'll just give the brief highlights of what's being proposed for the 2019 budget, and then we'll consider a proposed millage rate for the city and the Downtown Improvement Board.
Okay, thank you.
Which is September 25th at 5:00, but we will set that at the tentative hearing. So,
yep. Can I ask a quick question, just real quick? If the guys in the booth back there, just to make sure the volume's up loud enough, because we're going to the budget process, and then for us, if we're speaking, to make sure we get a little closer to the mic. So for Brandy, you as well, get a little closer so that people in the audience could hear as well.
Okay.
Okay.
Is that better?
Yes, ma'am. Thank
All
you.
All right.
Okay.
All right. So overall, our total budget is up 8.49%. That's about $8.5 million more than last year, and this is our total budget, including all funds. This is due to an increase in capital projects, including our infrastructure surtax projects and utilities projects, personnel cost, and debt service cost. The proposed budget includes a 2.5% cost of living adjustment for all employees. And the general fund is 5.56% more than last year, which is about $3.4 million. And the budget as presented was built with the current millage rate of 3.9740. All four CRA districts are included in the city's budget under special revenue fund section. Taxable values are up for all four CRA districts for next year, and TIF revenues are based on the city's and the county's current millage rates. The budget includes a transfer of $1.85 million from the general fund reserves to the capital projects funds for new or ongoing projects, and the infrastructure surtax funds of $3.2 million are included in the special revenues. The water and sewer rates are proposed to increase 3% based on the current rate study, and solid waste rates will increase 5% based on their current rate study. A recap of the past 10 fiscal years of our general fund revenue, and the the color-coded by revenue type, 2019 revenues are up 2.86%, which is about $1.1 million. Staff anticipates increases in ad valorem tax revenue, merchant license fee, and local option gas tax revenue. This chart is our taxable values over the last 10 years. The taxable values are up 2.67% from last year, from $2.321 to $2.384 billion. And as you can see from the chart, this is the third year in the row that we've had a slight increase in our values. This is our ad valorem tax and millage rate trend over the last 10 years. In 2008, we decreased our millage, and the rates have stayed around the same, around that 3.9 mark, and in next year's budget, it is included to keep the rate the same at 3.9740. Touch on our fund balance policy. The city's current fund balance policy suggests a target fund balance reserve of 30% for emergency and disasters, and 10% for unassigned reserve based on our prior year's annual budgeted general fund operating expenditures. That's the one that we reduced last year from 20% to 10%. So the expenditure budget was around $40.2 million, in which 30% is $12 million and 10% is $4 million, which totals a target fund balance of $16 million for fiscal year 19. Based on our policy and budgeted operating expenditures, the target reserve amount is 16. Our estimated current fund balance is $22 million. The proposed budget would reduce reserves by $5 million, $2.5 million for capital, and $2.5 for the officers that we approved last year and debt service. The use of fund balance will not jeopardize the targets established by the financial policies of the City Commission. Our operating capital is also known as capital outlay. It's included in each of the cost centers in the proposed budget. It purchases of short-term operating assets such as vehicles and equipment. And in the general fund, operating capital requests totaled over $2.8 million for 2019, and staff, we reduced that list down to $650,000. The CIAC capital improvement projects include acquisition or construction of long-term assets such as infrastructure projects, and the initial project list included over $3.4 million worth of new projects. We are proposing to transfer $1.85 from the general fund for new projects, and this will allow for the priority projects to be funded. Touch on a few of those projects that we will fund with that $1.85 million as to continue the police department main station facility upgrades, the fire station number 4 remodel, and that's on Jinks Avenue, and this will be phase 2. They have the design for that, and they'll be ready to do the construction, hopefully be finished by December. Dredging projects, the designs you all just approved will be to do the dredging at Lake Van Vack and Massalina Bayou. Jinks Avenue Street lighting, that's from 23rd Street to Baldwin, so that'll be lighting for the new road that we're finishing. Daffin Park improvements, MLK Rec Center upgrades, and this will be for new gym floor and scoreboards. and part two of the special needs playground over at the Oakland Terrace Park. For the utilities fund, we have several big projects and proposed to complete next year, including the Highway 390 utilities relocation, Beach Drive utility improvements, and this is the utilities portion of that project. The public works portion of that is funded with infrastructure surtax funds for next year. A lift station replacement, and this is lift station at the old airport site, and to construct our lab building at the St. Andrews Wastewater Treatment Plant facility. Solid Waste Fund will continue to convert their fleet over to compressed natural gas. And in the Marinas Fund, we've got funds in there to do some improvements to the Panama City Marina. To go over the ad valorem tax process and what we have to achieve with the TRIM process is inform taxpayers and public about the legislative process by which local ad valorem or property taxes are determined. So July 1, the property appraiser certified our taxable values, in which he got us our rates a little earlier this year. So by August 2nd, we'll have to let them certify our prior year millage rate, current year proposed rate, current year rollback rate, and schedule for the tentative budget hearing, which you just decided. So we'll have our first tentative hearing on September 13th, and we're proposing to have our final hearing on September 25th. So this is the proposed millage rate in which we are asking to get today to certify our value to the property appraiser, Department of Revenue, and tax collector. So the TRIM process requires local governments conform to the maximum millage limitation requirements, and they apply to all taxing authorities except school districts. So these set our thresholds and different rates. You can levy any rate that's statutory allowed up to, which our limit is 10 mils, but these are the thresholds stating that these rates, how many votes we would need for adoption. So our rollback rate for next year is 3.9249, and this will generate approximately the same amount of revenue as last year, which is about $98,000 less than what our current rate is because our revenues increased. The majority rate is an adjusted rollback rate plus an adjustment for growth in per capita Florida personal income, and that's 5.7335. This will require 3 out of 5 votes for adoption. The two-thirds rate are all rates between the majority rate and the maximum millage rate, requires 4 out of 5 votes, and it's 6.3069. And any rate above the two-thirds rate would require a unanimous vote. Jared is going to touch on the millage options that staff has come up with for you all, and a little history on our millage rate.
Yes, so we've proposed 4 different options for you today. Our current rate at 3.9740. The budget that we proposed with our current millage rate of 3.9740, this option reduces the fund balance by $5 million, of which $2.5 million are recurring costs. To cover the recurring personnel costs, or the 17 officers we brought on board last year, or said funded positions, I should say, the millage rate would need to increase to 4.51740. That's a 13% increase. It brings in $1.1 million of additional funds. For $100,000 of taxable value, it would increase a property tax bill by $4.53 a month. To cover the reoccurring debt service costs, the millage rate would need to increase to 4.6665, or a 17% increase, which brings in $1.4 million of additional funds. For $100,000 of taxable value, it would increase the property tax bill by $5.77 a month. And to cover both of those costs, the rate would need to be 5.2146, which would bring in $2.5 million of additional funds. And for a $100,000 taxable value, your property tax bill would increase by $10.34 a month. So just a little history on our millage rate. Our current rate of 3.9740 is one of the lowest rates since 1992. Current rate is only 0.0034 mils higher. That's 0.09% higher than it was in 1991. The city had a millage rate of 5 mils from 1992 to 2015, so 15 years. In 2006, the rate was reduced, and several times thereafter until code enforcement officers, additional code enforcement officers were hired in 2015. The commission made a public safety a priority last year with the approval of 17 new officer positions through lowering the unassigned target fund balance to 10%, which allowed the city to fund these positions from reserves. And I just want to note, over the years since we've lowered millage rate in 2006, you know, health insurance costs, goods and services, including contracts, building materials, et cetera, and wages have certainly gone up. So we've absorbed those costs through our current millage rate. But we've just got additional reoccurring expenses that are difficult to absorb in the current millage rate. But we did propose the current budget in front of you, doing so at our current millage rate.
Discussion?
So looking at the history, let me grab this thing right here. So looking at the history of our millage rate, I guess prior to 2005, I think that number, we were at 5%, and property values were up. And then around 2012, I think that's when the market started going down, and you see, we can see our revenues being reduced as well. I think we've done a good job just, you know, counting those pennies and changing the reserves, and I think over the last 2 years we've dipped in that reserve twice, and last year was to fund the officers. And the biggest question is we get the officers and we took it out of reserves, but it's not reoccurring. And so we've got to pay for that public safety somehow, some way, if we want to maintain those officers that we all agreed upon last year. Two, the course of doing business, and you all experience. I know health insurance is kind of crazy. When I saw the numbers, it's going up probably 10, 12, 15% a year. Just in the free market, and I don't think the city's any different. Two, I know the struggles we've had this year with staff on trying to get quality people to fill in the positions, CDL drivers, et cetera, or just, you know, maintenance workers. One, you can't fill those positions, and so yet you have to give a decent pay. And I know cities are always 3 or 4 years behind the regular marketplace. And so I think we've done a great job up to this point, and today we have to strongly think about what number we throw today and continue to go back to staff until September to fine-tune these numbers to make sure that we maintain the officers, maintain the path that we're going on with infrastructure improvements. I mean, when I first got in, it was brown water. I know we're fixing a lot of that stuff. And I think that's important to the citizens of Panama City. Fortunate part, you have your goods and services. The price is what it is. You got to try to buy something, and the market's up. You got to pay that price to get the jobs done. And it's just amazes me what it costs to build a road or repave a road or lay a pipe down. And unfortunately, you got to get an engineer to give you the engineering stuff, which costs money to do that. And so those extra costs that, you know, as citizens, maybe if we're doing something in our house, we don't pay or not required to have. And unfortunately, we have to do it to make sure the stuff works. I think it's just a tough decision on what, you know, where we go from here. But I know that I've been in meetings with management probably 3 or 4 times already in the last 2 weeks, just trying to fine-tune this and trying to come up with some additional
avenues or thought processes that we could take as a city, so we don't overburden one of the parts for this. The other part, too, is though out, and I don't know if a lot of the citizens know this, but in November, there's going to be on the ballot to reduce your homestead additional $50,000. And another 25? I mean, another 25? Okay. So another $25,000. I'm going to vote for that. I mean, I want to pay less taxes on my homestead. And so that comes back and affects the city as well, because we lose that tax revenues to do it. And we have to plan. I mean, it's coming, and I think probably, you know, 90% of people that have a homestead are going to vote for that. You know, I mean, why not? But that puts the city back in a bind on not gathering that revenues throughout that that process year. So, anyways, that was just my thought. With the cost of doing business, the infrastructure we're doing, and trying to get quality employees, and the fact that, you know, if you're getting a revenue at a period of time, and you start reducing that, you're losing that revenues, you're losing your reserves, you don't have that money to extend you out in a period of time. And we have been one of the lowest. And you look at the city and all the stuff that we have, and we have two marinas. We got a port. We got an intermodal facility. We have two universities here, a college and a university. We have a lot of stuff. We have a lot of people that go through our community as well, getting from one location to another. So there's a lot that we have that we have to address and make sure that we provide that quality of life for the citizens that live here. So that was just my comments.
Other commission comments?
All right.
Long as
go ahead, Mr.
I hope not. You covered a lot, though. Yeah, actually, you asked some good questions and some of the same comments that I've been thinking about, too. I always try to think about sticker shock. When you go to buy a car, you know, or you're looking to buy a house, and I just experienced that. My son purchased a house. I didn't purchase it. He did, but I was in touch with him every day, and I was just amazed at the price of houses. They're going up, and there's an abundance of them, and they're selling. I mean, at least in certain parts of the city they are, and in the county. Man, it's tough. It is hard. I have never been one in my life want to raise any tax. I can't stand it. It just makes me sick at my stomach to have to do it. But these figures are not lying to us. And the city is not in the business of making money. The city is in the business of providing services. But we've got to at least break even. We've got to do that when you think of it in terms of a business. And I was asking Brandy earlier when I arrived this morning on this one chart, if we can go back to that chart. It's called the general fund revenue chart, so that everybody understands, because I didn't. The part that's green is the 1 cent license merchant fee. So, and I think you told me you're expecting a $300,000 increase this year.
Yes.
That's, you know, for the coming year. Yeah. And we do have a lot of new businesses that have come into town. We've lost some, too. So, you know, I really don't, you know, it's hard to say, gosh, I can support which one of these, you know. If I had my way about it, I wouldn't raise them at all. But I realize if what we set today, we can go backwards. We can decrease. But we sure can't go up. So just because whatever we set today doesn't mean that we will approve that for the final trick. I want people to understand that.
Yes, that is true. You know, you're setting a proposed millage today, and you can go down from here, but you cannot go raise it from here. So in September, you couldn't set it at 3.9 and then want to go to 4 in September.
Right, right. So, you know, really, I don't have any other comments to say. I know, you know, we've all, I'm just like Commissioner Nichols, that's a no-brainer. The homestead exemption is going to pass. You know, heck, we're all going to vote for that. Nobody, anyway, you can save a buck, you'll do it. You know, I don't know. That's, I'd like to hear what the other guys had to think, you know. Mayor, I really want to hear what you have to say.
Ralph?
Well, when I was talking to Mr. Jarrett, and for last year, I think I made a, trying to get a proposal to raise taxes. But he assured me that we was doing fine the way we were, and with all the material and all of the activities in which we were having going today. I talked to him about it again this year, and he said it again. We're doing fine. I was kind of reluctant to believe him this time, but I'm going to give him one more chance. I'm going to go with him. Mr. Jarrett, he's the guy we got here. He's the man that's supposed to be doing it. So I'm going to agree with him and go with him again this year. We're going to maintain everything as is. But everything the commissioners have already said, I kind of concur, and we had a conversation concerning the same effect. I'm going to go with you again, Mr. And I'm going to...
Where are you going, Jared?
Yep, I'm going to go...
Yeah, I just want
to... Now, this is just between he and I.
Okay.
This is just between he and I, because we had a real good conversation, long conversation on this exact topic. And just between he and I, I'm gonna go with what he recommend that we do.
I think he recommended to all of us probably.
I think I've been employing people for over 40-something years. We are a service organization. The city's a service organization. We have over 500 employees. The cost of keeping people safe, yeah, we had to raise the number of employees to keep people safe. And last year, we pulled it out of the reserves. And we can only go out of reserves for things for a certain amount of time. Thank goodness that our values are up close to 3%. So our millage doesn't have to go up as much as it needs to have the revenue to do what we need to do, and that service the public. I don't care who's in office in Washington. I can never remember from one year to the next my health insurance for my business and my employees ever going down. Do you? Did they ever send you a thing saying, guess what? Your health insurance went down. And it's not going to happen. And in order for us to retain the kind of people that we need to run this city, we have to have decent benefits. We have to have health, good health insurance. And we need to make sure that we pay a somewhat of a competitive wage to keep them in place, to keep that experience there so that when something happens and they have to come out and fix something, they know what they're doing. So, I think that we're going to have to, we may have to go up a little this year. There is going to be some tweaking between now and September. But as far as the rate goes, I believe that we probably need to start it at 5.21. I mean, that's what I think. We may have to, you know, in between now and then roll back in between and come up with something a little less. But we can't really start lower, and we can't raise it later. So that's my comments.
I think 5.2, you said 5.21? I don't, yeah, that's a figure that's not really listed, but it's got to be really close to what it, you know, what we're looking at here to, well, it is listed. That's a recurring personal debt cost.
It takes care of the costs that we have.
Sorry. So the question when you're looking at those numbers and everybody else is looking at those numbers as well, you've got one number that your personnel cost to make sure you maintain those and the public safety that we all agreed upon that the citizens need. Reoccurring debt and the cost of doing business falls in that next category. So 1 point do you say, hey, we're going to, you know, tell the chief that, you know, really can't have those officers. Or, you know, we're going to, you know, cut back on public safety. Or, you know, the cost of doing business is what it is. So, you know, I think this is July. That I still think we have time to work this budget. I know we've had a couple of conversations, but this is kind of where staff puts out all their stuff and say, this is what, you know, you know, we need to make sure the city's moving forward in a good direction. I would tell you is if you throw a number out there, if as the mayor said, 5.21, and that's the start, and then by September, we get in there and we sharpen that pencil and get down and figure out, you know, what other areas that we could focus on, see where, at the end of the day, our costs are going to be, and get that number closer to that 4.5 number to do it. I mean, again, if you look that, if you got your savings account, you got money in, and you're spending it down, all of a sudden you get to that critical moment, you got to bring it back up. And unfortunately, as a city, we got to do it slowly, but we got to make sure we have that staff to provide the services that we need. I mean, we get emails all the time about, you know, we had that little issue with the trash and picking up the trash, and you know, it's tough to fill those spots if we can't pay these guys enough to come work here. They're going somewhere else. So I think we have to have that conversation between now and September 13th.
Okay. So, do I hear a motion?
I'll move just to set it today that our goal is to make sure that we do what we can to reduce this number, but I'll move to set it today at, based on what staff has been telling me, the 5.2146, that will reduce that number by September 13th.
I'll second that motion, Mayor.
Okay, any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes.
We also need to set a rate for the Downtown Improvement Board. Their current millage rate is at 3.0000 mills, and their taxable values are up slightly at 0.75%. Their board is proposing the three mills to stay the same, which would bring in about $430 more dollars to them than their rollback rate.
Your motion?
Let me just say real quick, I know Commissioner Halligas is not here, so that was kind of another reason why I wanted to do that 5.2, based on, you know, what her thoughts and I know stuff that she's been working on since she's been in office. So again, that's a great, you know, conversation for that. Two is, you know, I think at the end of the day, we really have to address the millage for downtown. I mean, if you, whatever number you put and you add that on top of it, it's going to be tough for those businesses down there. So again, as the discussion for today, because I've not seen a budget from the DIB, and the one I've looked at last year, I'll make the motion to do it at three mills today. The fact that we're going to have some serious conversation with the DIB and possibly reducing that to some other number moving forward.
Here's a second.
I'll second the motion, Mayor.
Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes. Okay, at this time we'll have audience participation. I know that we're going to have a presentation. I want you to go last. So is there anybody that would like to address the commission?
I'd like to address the commission on something. Oh, we got somebody. Okay. Okay.
Good morning, Rufus Wood, 1911 East 10th Street. Delighted to be here this morning, and Mr. Mayor, I'm glad to hear you say that the city's in the business of service. We need some service. Most of you know that we've been fighting for Oscar Patterson for a long time. The future of the school was hanging in the balance, it was uncertain, but thank God the children made the C and the school will remain open. We feel that the children deserve to be celebrated for their academic achievement. They made the C and we know they can do so much, much more if they are given the resources that they need, and we intend to see that through. But we're gonna have a celebration on August 11th at Patterson from 11 o'clock until 3 o'clock to celebrate the children. Also, we're going to be giving them supplies as they return to school, and we need some help. So I don't know if y'all have any resources available, and if the city does not have resources, this is one of the city schools, I would ask each of you to contribute to help us to put this over for the children. I think we deserve to do something for the children. I think they deserve to be recognized for their achievement. And so I'm asking you to help us. We need finances, and I've given you the letter that was written, the flyer, along with the list of back-to-school supplies. Whatever you can do to help us, I would appreciate it. Now, on your flyer and your letter, it says a backpack of back-to-school supplies. I had a meeting yesterday. They said, Reverend, it's going to cost probably $3,000 to $4,000 just for the backpacks. So now, if we don't get enough money, we won't do the backpacks, but we will give the supplies. But I'm saying, in order for us to do this, it's a community effort. We're leading it, but we're asking the community to help us. And I'm depending on you all to help us to do it. So I would appreciate a financial contribution, or if you would decide to help us with some supplies. It is all about the children. Again, we know that they can do so much, much more. My third grade teacher taught me good, better, best. Never let it rest until your good is better and your better is best. They made the C, and we know that they have the ability to do even more. But we want to invest in our children. I'm asking you to help us to do that. So I will be looking to hear from each of you, particularly you, Commissioner Brown. I know you will lead the way, as you always have done, and Mayor. Thank you so much. And if y'all will make sure that Commissioner Halligas will receive copies. I know she's out of town, but I'm sure she would want to participate. Thank you.
I would like to say something.
Nothing like being subtle.
I think this is important because we are so blessed in Panama City and in Olive Bay County. This is one of the most giving communities. I'm telling you, folks, I meet people from all over the United States in my line of work, and our community is an incredible. They step up to the plate when they need to. And there's a lot of churches right now, including my church, a city church at Northside, St. Dominic Catholic, I think, is helping. They always do. St. John's does. And they're all doing backpacks, and they're all helping with this. So have you reached out to any churches to, because a lot of churches are adopting schools right now. Just out of curiosity.
We have reached out to some, and we only have a couple of weeks. As you know, we were not sure what was going to happen with the school. And we only recently found out, we had known, we would have been planning months in advance, but we didn't have much time. So we're in the early stages. But anybody that you know that you can give us those names, we'd be happy to contact them. We just need help. As you know, most of the families in that area, a lot of them are economically deprived, and the children need the help. So we're asking you all to help us. And anybody you know that's willing to do that, please call me, and I will be happy to call them or meet with them, because we only have a couple of weeks to pull this together.
And after the meeting, if you'll see me, I'll be happy to write you a personal check, too.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
All right.
And
take care.
And that goes for the audience, too. Thank you all.
Thank you.
And
Walter P. Henry, 614 Maple Avenue, Panama City, Florida. I give honor to our mayor and to our commissioners. Nothing we all have already been through. I just have some questions. I just like to know why we're starting backwards on a water line that y'all starting at 11th Street going through from 11th Street to St. Andrews. Know that what you have said, the line is probably full of, but one thing I do know that line probably before the city even got their own water, kind of started getting water from the county, those lines used to be pump lines. And I know they got lots of fuel in them and everything, they can't help. Back in the day, they just bleed in cast iron until they made duct iron. Some folks think duct iron and cast iron is a different pipe. But we see that. I don't know why y'all not starting from the Millville treatment plant, working your way to St. Andrews. That line was the main line of the Panama City. It fed from all of the from that main Panama City station. I know we had one in St. Andrews as well. But I just wonder why we are going backwards. I don't know where your second phase go start from, or where that go be the end of it. I just wanted to know that. Another problem I have, I've heard the lift station in the old airport. At I don't know if it's anyone. That station have been changed many times, and I don't know if nobody thought about it. What can be done to keep throwing all the money into that? Into that station. The station is needed, but we need to find what sewer eating it up. What is, somebody ought to know what can be done to keep it. I know they've tried many things, it hadn't worked. But we just putting money in the thing, but I don't think we're trying to find out how we can continue to stop putting money in stuff that we know that down through the years, and we go end up keep putting money in it. I think we need to find a way or talk to somebody other than ourselves and give us some facts how to get these things done.
Chris, will you explain to Mr. Henry after the meeting about what we're doing with that pipe from St. Andrews to 11th? Okay. Thank you, Mr. Henry.
Anyone else?
Go ahead.
Mayor, I forgot to also say, I knew when I started mentioning churches, I shouldn't do that, because there's at least 15 others that I've heard about.
There's a bunch.
God bless all of them that are helping.
There's a bunch.
Morning, I'm Cal Zethmer. I'm a fairly new resident of Panama City, 702 19th Street West. Just moved here from Crestview, where for the past 15 years I was involved in news coverage for one of the big stations over that way, and covered a lot of meetings, even in this room, for the Triumph Board. On your comments about your sound system, you have what we call in radio a Vox system. You don't have control of pushing a button like Okaloosa County commissioners do or Dayton Council to turn on their mic and turn it off, and a little red light lights up. Yours depends on the speaker having enough volume close to this microphone and all of those. When I covered the Triumph meeting, I would miss great quotes because the speaker was back over here and didn't move the electronics in the system back there, and I've talked to the guys in the booth about that. My other reason for getting up, I attended the little event last night down at the marina, and I noticed one thing that was missing down there. The past 15 years, I was an active board member, committee chair with the Main Street Crestview Association, and also on the City Council-appointed Historic Preservation Board. In a few months, you're going to start seeing pictures in the News Herald, I'm sure, of the new courthouse that will be opening this fall in Crestview, 100 years since the first courthouse opened in 1918. And our committee in particular was strong in convincing the county commissioners to have the architects design this new courthouse to look like a much bigger version of the original beautiful white columns in front, 1918 building, a historical appearing building still serving the needs of today. But what I saw missing, and what I've seen in other cities I've been to Main Street events, Panama, over in Pensacola, Milton, other places, Punta Gorda and other towns, no picnic benches, no place for somebody to sit down. There were three food trucks, and I and some others just had a stand. We didn't probably think to bring lawn chairs to sit on and eat there. But there was a whole lot of space between the food trucks and the, what I would call the bay end of the park area, before you got to where the people were sitting and enjoying the music. So maybe the downtown board or some of your other civic organizations would say, we can do some picnic benches. We did some in Crestview by having the young men in our juvenile center volunteer the labor, and all we did was provide the materials at a good reduced cost from a local vendor of wood, to have some nice looking wooden picnic benches down there. Something to think about. Thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Jane Lindsay, 551 Harrison Avenue. I first of all want to thank you for the consideration of the three mills for the DIB. As you know, we've had a few struggles over the past few years, and we're looking forward to maybe gathering ourselves, but we need you to help us to do that. When you receive the request to be on the DIB, I would appreciate if you'd look at a commitment. A commitment being something that somebody wants to put their whole heart in. As you know, I've been in business 30-plus years here, and I've enjoyed being on the DIB. It's been a work of love and labor. But anyway, I'd like for you to also consider the fact of not only commitment, but we need to have a variety of backgrounds. We don't need to have five of any one type of people. It is an example, which we don't have, but like five restaurant people or five whatever. So we would appreciate you really scrutinizing that. They need to be a property owner. They need to, or else to pay the ad valorem tax. That is in our bylaws. So I would like for you to consider that as an issue also. I appreciate all you do to help us. I know, like I say, we've been through a lot, and we want to go forward and help downtown in any way we can. So we need your guidance. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Jane.
Mayor?
Yes.
I just want to bring a little good thing about the Glenwood Working Partnership. Years ago, I think the Glenwood Working Partnership received a grant for about $10,000 or something, and Mrs. Barbara Moore traveled around the area, and not only just Panama City, Lynn Haven, some everywhere. And they made interviews of some of the senior citizens. And last night, I think, at Gulf Coast State College, there was a viewing of some of those artifacts. And I understand that there was a movie or film that drawed up about that. And one of the things that they said was these Glenwood interviews we did so long ago still got a ton of people watching, and we receive nice comments every month about one of those videos. These people we interview will play forever.
I got to see that. I got to see that 3 or 4 years ago. Somebody showed it to me. It's pretty neat.
That is the main concept behind African American Culture Center and bringing the historical effects here. And we need to kind of advocate and get the board back on track so we could come in, because in those stories, the legacies of the families placed in, should be placed in a storehouse of knowledge. A true record is what we need that will last forever. Thank you.
Very good. Okay, no one else? Frank, you want to come up and do your...
Frank DiPinto, 1400 Gulf Avenue, apartment number 4. Got it. Signal me, you'll get it up in a few minutes. Panama City Public Works Department is proposing to redesign the existing grassy marine parkway from a strong north-south linear format to a destructive curvilinear format. Existing format, linear, strong axis from downtown all the way through the marina up to Shell Island. This is the proposed city council. It's part of their marina seawall repair. And as you can see, it radically changes that linear format to a curvilinear format. Larger scale. To my left, the existing. To my right, the proposed, the existing, you can see the strong linear axial coming from downtown. That gives us its strength and beauty, and it's supported by the form of the existing parkway with the linear sides both on the west and the east and the parkway. There it is right there. The parkway redesign is not necessary. It works. It's beautiful. Why change it? A curvilinear roadway format would be a nuisance to drive to navigate. This is easy. It works. You can see people come up and down, park. They don't have to navigate a curve. The curvilinear format would be a waste of taxpayers' money. It would be a lot of money to tear up that linear format of the parkway now. I'm sorry. Tear it up now, and then not only pay that expense for tearing it up, but also paying for the expense of adding new. Can I get a couple extra seconds because that's delay? There's the island that we can see that's at the end of the axis that runs from Government Street through the marina, through the parkway, and these are the people enjoying the present spaces there. The existing linear format on both the parkway and the roadways make it easy for vendors, entertainment, stages, kids' play structure area, crowd circulation, and very convenient and easy for them to have those activities there. Curvilinear format would make these activities more cumbersome. The curvilinear format would destroy the linear continuity and strength and the beauty of the Marina Parkway. I appreciate your time, and thank you.
We're going to go right into our CRA. No, I asked if anybody that wanted to, no, go ahead, but I asked if anybody wanted to speak, and I was going to have him go last, but go ahead. That's okay.
Mike Rowan, 239 South Cove Terrace. I don't very often agree with Frank, but I sort of agree with him on keeping this straight. But what I want to know is what proposals are being made for the marina. I was not aware that anything was happening except the last time I talked down here, we were talking about the T-deck or the T-wall, the bulkhead out there being fixed. So what kind of plans are happening?
We don't know where that came from.
So. Great, I don't know. Great question. None.
None. Yeah, there aren't any.
So this curvilinear business is
yes,
somebody's just, imagination.
I guess it was something that was proposed a long time ago, but no, we haven't adjusted any of that.
So right now, nothing's happening.
That's correct.
No. Okay.
Not a thing.
I want to come in about 2 weeks and see if we can get something to happen, something good.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.
Commissioner, I mean, Mayor, if there's a spot here for the executive session, would you like to take a pause and do CRA?
Then no, let's
back to the executive session.
Yeah, that'd be great.
You want to do it that way, or
you want to do
go
the,
ahead
yeah, let's,
with the executive CRA. Session?
Yeah, let's go ahead and do CRA.
Yeah.
Okay, our commission meeting is adjourned.
It's not adjourned.
Well,
we're just
temporarily.
Pausing. Yeah, we're it will be reconvened for the purpose of the executive session, and then and at the conclusion of the executive session we'll come back here, but it's being paused for the purpose of conducting the CRA.
Call a roll for CRA.
Ms. Halagas is not present. Mr. Brown?
Here.
Mr. Rader?
Here.
Mr. Nichols?
Here.
And Chairman Brudnicki?
Here. Under new business, we've got consideration of awarding a bid for Martin Luther King Center splash pad resurfacing.
So the city accepted sealed bids in duplicate form for MLK Rec Center splash pad surfacing. The bids were invited upon items to work as follows. Install approximately 3,600 square feet of EVA rubber copolymer wet area surface system for the splash pad at the MLK Rec Center at 705 East 14th Court, Panama City, Florida. Engineer's estimate for the work was $4,000. The purchasing department received two bids for this project on June 7th. Forever Lawn Emerald Coast at $34,000 and Erosion Control Specialists at $56,000. Forever Lawn deviated from the plans and used a material that was not approved prior to the bid. The department head recommendation is to increase funds for this project and to award the bid to Erosion Control Specialists.
Hear motion?
Approve.
Second.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Mr. Rader?
Yes.
Mr. Nichols?
Yes.
Chairman Brudnicki?
Yes. At this time, we have public comment for the CRA. If anyone would like to come and address this, do so at this time. Okay, seeing no one, CRA is adjourned.
Hey, okay. Nevin, before you speak, I don't know how long this executive session is going to last, but the CDC meeting is very short, probably 15 minutes. Is it possible we can just, while we're here, just continue to do that program and then go into executive session and end? Is that
okay,
a problem?
Well, right now the city commission is in a recess.
Okay.
You know how you recess for water and all? So if you want to continue that recess, you may, and then we'll bring the city commission meeting back to order. I believe the estimate will be around 30 minutes for the executive session. Maybe.
Hey, you want to go ahead and 45. Do the CDC let's first? That'd be great.
Yeah, let's go ahead and do the CDC.
No problem.
And do that. So we'll go ahead and do that. And
hey, CRA is adjourned. We're going to have a CDC meeting as soon as we get set up.
DC Destination Panama City meeting for July 24th to order. And Ms. Vigil,
We are on a fast track today, so we'll keep it that way. But before you call the roll, I would take the honor of introducing our two board members that we've elected the last meeting to add. And we have the first, Nero Banker from Roadway Inn as a new board member. Welcome. And Janine Brown from the Holiday Inn as well as a new board member. Thank you. So we have seven board members. We have two from our partners, as long as us as a commission. So it's great to get your input and knowledge and letting us know what's going through. I guess we use the small hotel part, and then the large, I think, is what we chose on. So it's great to get actually input from what the hoteliers are experiencing. So thank you for your time, and thank you for serving, and hopefully you find it as rewarding as we do. Thank you. Thank you. Right. Ms. Vigil?
After I do the roll call, I'm just going to have to ask for an add-on of the 990 tax form, and it's already been completed and submitted. It's just for your acceptance. Roll call, Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Allegus is not here. Ms. Brown?
Here. Thank you.
Mr. Banker?
Here.
Mr. Brudnicki?
Here.
Mr. Rader?
Here.
Chairman Nichols?
Here.
I just need a motion to accept the add-on of accepting the 990 tax documents.
Motion to accept the 990 as presented.
I'll second the motion.
Motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries.
Do you want to just do that first and
roll call now?
Since you that's fine. Sorry.
Oh, you did a roll call, didn't you?
Well, that was just to accept it onto the agenda, and now I need a motion to accept the actual 990 tax form.
But I have a motion to accept the 990.
Motion to accept the 990 as filed and presented.
Second the motion.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries.
Arlene has the financial statements.
Included in your packet is a financial statement for June 30th, 2018. Total assets were $186,000 with the unrestricted net position of $86,000. And on the next page, on 1-2, we have a statement of revenues and expenses. Total revenues for the year-to-date were $1,112,000. Total expenses, $1,057,000, with a net increase in net position of $54,000.
So do we have a motion to accept the financial report?
So moved.
Second.
And a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries.
Next, you have the acceptance of the tourist development tax report. And you'll notice that we are still trending down about 1.15% overall based on the number of rooms and inventory that we have. We're relatively stable from where we were last year because of the reduction in rooms. Accept the TDT.
Motion.
I have a motion and a second. I have a second. Any discussion or questions in reference to the tourist development tax report? Good. I think it's stable, and I think when that flyover gets done, I think that those hotels will pick back up. It'll be a little easier to get to. So, all right. I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries. Thank you.
Next, we have the approval of minutes from the May 8th, 2018 meeting.
May 8th meeting.
Second the motion.
Okay. I have a motion and a second. No changes to the minutes. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Next thing I need is to approve an additional meeting on August 28th, 2018. It'll be following the City Commission meeting. It's that time of year again. Our budget first goes to you. Then it goes to Bay County Tourist Development Council, and then it actually goes to the Bay County Commission. So that is the point in time when we, on the 28th, is when we present the budget to you that we plan on putting forward. We just recently got our numbers collection number from the county budget office. We just got that.
Motion, make a second on the August 28th meeting.
I have a motion and a second. Mr. Rader was made a motion, and Mr. Bernicki made the second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Next item is approve an additional meeting on November the 5th, and that is for the purpose of the marketing and public relations presentation. This is going to be unlike our normal meetings in that it will be lengthy. This is the time when we will be having the respondents from the shortlisted respondents from the marketing RFQ come in and make their presentations. We expect to pick at least 3 to 4 firms and giving them each 30 to 45 minutes to make a presentation. Sharon Churchwell has looked at all your calendars, so we just need you to either decide on the morning or the afternoon and then approve that for us today. It's a Tuesday, I believe, or Monday? No, I think it's a Monday, to be honest with you.
Motion for the additional meeting on November 5th.
Second the motion.
I've got a motion. It's Monday. Yeah, I have it down sometime between 9 and 5. Yeah. So I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
Did you want to decide on morning or afternoon?
She's already got it on my calendar for the morning.
Okay.
Yeah. I want to do 8 o'clock where you state.
That's what's here.
Get through the day.
Yep. Right,
for new board members, you're good with that as well. Mm-hmm. All right, so Monday, November 5th at 8 a.m. at this location. Have you verified with the county if this room is available on that date?
Even if this room is not, we can get one of the small rooms in the
we
side.
Can. All
yeah.
right.
And there's so, dais back there as well.
Very good. I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All right. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries for November 5th at 8 a.m. at the county offices.
A really quick president's report. We have you recently approved going out for 3 commercial appraisals. We couldn't get 3 commercial appraisers that could complete the job in a specific amount of time and for a specific price point. So the owner of the property agreed on having 2. Our first appraisal came in relatively low. The second appraisal just came in. We're going to go over those with the owner of the building and see where she stands, and then we'll be bringing back a recommendation at the next meeting. The update on the marketing and public relations RFQ, we have at least 3 to 4 firms that I know of that are putting in a response to our RFQ. So we are happy about getting to look at different options. Update on gateway signage. I'm going to be getting with each one of you individually. We've worked with some sign companies, and we want to get your input on what you like about each sign, so maybe we can come up with a comprehensive sign that meets kind of what everybody would like to see before we go public with any of them. Update on the FY19 budget schedule. Like I said, we did just get our numbers from Ashley Stuckey and Miranda in the county budget office this past week. So we're just tweaking our budget and making sure that that is ready for August 22nd or August 28th. And then the next quarterly meeting is October 23rd, 2018.
Any questions for Ms. Vigil? Oh, okay. That leads us into item 9, public participation. Would anybody from the audience like to come forward and speak? Not seeing anyone. That would adjourn the Destination Panama City meeting on July 24th. So from that, we'll go to executive session.
Yeah, well, right now, the City Commission is still in recess. It will reconvene here momentarily, and at that time, you'll receive an announcement about the executive session.
Blake, are you back in City Commission meeting now? You're back in the City Commission meeting now?
Yes.
Forum purposes anyway?
The mayor has just announced that the City Commission meeting has been reconvened and the recess is over.
At the request of your city.
But we need 5 minutes.
Yes, sir. I'll just read this and you can start now if you'd like. At the request of your city attorneys, we provided notice of an executive session to discuss litigation strategy and settlement opportunities in the case Jack Stewart versus City of Panama City, acting by and through its Board of Adjustment, Bay County Circuit Court case number 18-300CA. We're going to recess this meeting and go into room 1023, which is straight to the back there, gentlemen. The executive session will be closed to the public. In attendance at the meeting will be the mayor, all of the city commissioners present, interim city manager Jared Jones, attorneys Nevin Zimmerman, Mike Burke, Natalie McSwain, and a certified court reporter. We estimate this session will take 1 hour. Pursuant to Florida law, the executive session will be recorded by the court reporter. No portion of the session will be off the record. The court reporter's notes will be fully transcribed and filed with the city clerk, made a part of the public record upon conclusion of the pending litigation. And at the conclusion of the executive session, we'll reconvene in this room in order to conclude the business.
Just a note, although the estimate is an hour, if it takes quicker than that, then it's okay. So just in case anybody's waiting, it could be less than an hour, probably will be.
All right. Reconvening the city commission meeting.
Thank you, Mayor, Commissioners. Mike Burke on behalf of the City Attorney's Office. Commissioners, we have before you this morning a proposed settlement agreement in the case of Jack Stewart versus City of Panama City, acting by and through its Board of Adjustment, Bay County Circuit Court, case number 18-300-CA. This relates to a variance appeal where Mr. Stewart applied to the Board of Adjustment for a variance to build a dock that would exceed the criteria for the City of Panama City, that criteria being that a dock cannot go beyond the limits or reach a limit that is 4 feet in depth. That's the should be the terminating point of it. Mr. Stewart is looking to construct a dock that would actually go out to 7 feet in depth, and that's in order to accommodate a larger vessel that he has that he would like to use that dock for. And I'm sorry, I should have said for the record a moment ago, the property is located at 1511 Michigan Avenue in Panama City. For every variance that is application that is made to the Board of Adjustment, there are certain criteria that have to be met. I'm going to just read off the questions from the application so that you know what those are. A, strict compliance with the provisions of the Land Development Regulation Code would deprive the property owner rights and privileges enjoyed by other properties in the area or the same zoning district, or to render the enforcement of the Land Development Regulation Code impractical. That's the first criteria. The planning staff found that that criteria had been met. Two, conditions for which the variance is being applied are unique or unusual to the site or structure in question. Staff found that that criteria had been met. Variance request is not based solely upon the desire to reduce the cost of developing a site. That criteria had been met. The variance shall not confer on the petitioner the grant of special privilege or be based on a self-imposed hardship. The staff found that that criteria had been met. The proposed variance will alter the essential character of the area surrounding the site. That criteria had also been met. The proposed variance will not degrade level of service standards as established in the comprehensive plan. That criteria had been met. And the effect of the proposed variance is in harmony with the general intent of the Land Development Regulation Code and the specific intent of the relevant provisions thereof. And staff also found that that criteria had been met. The facts are that Mr. Stewart applied for an extension of his existing 504-foot dock to be 150 feet longer, be a total length of 654 feet, and that dock would reach a depth that would be a minimum depth of 7 feet at mean low tide. He applied for the variance application to the Board of Adjustment, and a hearing was held in November on this matter. At the Board of Adjustment hearing, Mr. Stewart presented evidence regarding his regarding the seven criteria plus the staff report as evidence for his approval or his request for the approval of the variance application. After some discussion and a lengthy meeting, the Board of Adjustment denied the application. Mr. Stewart filed an appeal of that matter, alleging that due process had not been followed in the hearing matter. After some discussion with his counsel, Ms. Denise Rowan and Nick Utes, we discussed a potential for offering a settlement to the city on this particular matter, and that settlement is before you today. The settlement criteria would be that Mr. Stewart would be granted the variance application. This board would, in other words, not oppose it. It would be granted to him to exceed the 4 foot depth mark. But in return for that, there are certain concessions which Mr. Stewart's experts and consultants had made during the variance application hearing regarding conditions of the dock. And Mr. Stewart proposes that if the city would agree that the variance is approved, that he can go out an additional 150 feet to meet the 7 foot depth mark so that there would not be prop scarring or damage to the environment, that Mr. Stewart would be sure that all of the federal state permitting requirements promulgated by either the Army Corps of Engineers or the Florida Department of Environmental Protection or any other agency would be met. Mr. Stewart still has to complete his application with those agencies. So this is not, any action you take today would not actually give him the permission to go build the dock yet. He still has permitting steps to go through. Two, the proposed dock extension will not include mooring pilings as discussed in the board meeting on February 26th. That is significant because the original proposal that Mr. Stewart had went out actually 250 feet at the end of the dock. At the termination of that dock, there was a boathouse and a landing pad and then mooring piles so that his he could keep his vessel there all the time instead of just on a limited basis. After pushback from the community, he reduced that to 150 feet and agreed that he would not keep the boat there for extended periods of time. Third, the proposed dock extension will contain lighting that's consistent with the existing lighting on the current dock and extend for the extension of the proposed dock. That was based on some comments made regarding safety and whether or not folks could see that dock at night because it would be a little longer than what someone might expect. Fourth, that he would utilize the dock for temporary mooring only to include loading or unloading of passengers, crew, and equipment, or such other uses permitted by law, and provided that Stewart shall not moor any vessel for any period, that's any vessel, for any period greater than 3 nights. So the most that any boat would stay there would be 3 nights. From what I understand from the transcript, Mr. Stewart has another location where he keeps the boat on a permanent. I think it's a better protected harbor for him. So he just needed this more for those short-term times of when he's enjoying the vessel. And then finally, and most importantly, I think, to the City Commission, is that all of the above restrictions would be contained within a restrictive covenant that would be added to Mr. Stewart's deed for that property, and it would be in favor of the City Commission that you could enforce that covenant if it should be violated. And it should be noted that that doesn't end with Mr. Stewart. The good part of that is that when Mr. Stewart finally decides to sell that home or someone else takes it over and they want to do something different to that dock, they are limited to the restrictions that are included within the from now until it's gone. And commissioners,
any other questions of council?
I think the only question that I might have is has he had pushback from any of the neighbors?
Yes, sir. The transcripts show that there were neighbors that showed up and had disapproved of it, and that was really the basis of the appeal.
It doesn't look like there's very many neighbors, to be honest, that have boat docks, from what I'm looking at, pictures that I see.
Based on what we have heard in our executive session and the explanation from council, I'd like to know if someone would entertain a motion to accept the settlement agreement with one caveat, and it's just something simple, that our city clerk is no longer Terry Lillard, but Darlene Hackmeister, so we have to change that. But other than that, do I hear a motion that we accept the settlement agreement as presented today?
Yes, I move approval to accept it.
I'll second the motion, Mayor.
Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnicki?
Yes, ma'am.
My apologies, Ms. Hockmeister, for not catching that, too.
All right, no problem.
Thank you, Mayor.
Okay, anything else? We're adjourned.